Hi guys, Erin here. In this video, you'll learn about measurement artifacts and the biases that researchers can unconsciously introduce into a study and which may influence the results. We're going to talk about three main types, why they're a problem, and ways that we can avoid them. Here's where this video fits into the context of our course. So I want you to imagine this scenario. A researcher is testing the effectiveness of a reading remediation program for children that struggle with reading. During lessons, she sees that children's reading actually improves a lot throughout the program. However, when she looks at their scores at the end of the course, she finds that their scores actually didn't improve very much from where they were at the beginning of the program. When she looks at the scores from the first testing session, she notices they're really high. I want you to pause the video and think for a second about what could possibly explain this lack of change and what you would suggest to this researcher for future studies. Go ahead and pause it now and think about it. Well, this is an example of a range effect and specifically a ceiling effect. Basically, because kids' scores were already pretty high at the first testing session, there was no room for them to improve. This is a problem because the researcher might have actually come to the conclusion that the reading remediation program didn't impact kids' results and didn't impact their reading, when in fact it did. It was just the measurement was too easy and was not sensitive enough to pick up on the change. Similarly, if the test was too hard, we'd get what's called the floor effect, where we'd show no change in kids' performance over time, not because they didn't make a change in performance, but because the test was just not sensitive to pick up on that change. This is a problem because a study that shows no change or over time or no difference between groups might simply have found those results and come to that conclusion because the measurement was not well suited to the skill level of the participants and it wasn't able to detect that difference or that change. So the solution is to always try out an experiment before you actually go and do it. We call this piloting. You want to make sure that your measurement is appropriate to the skill level of your participants. Let's give you another example. Imagine this scenario. You're a clinical researcher that's developed a new drug to treat ADHD. You're really excited about your new product, and you're about to launch a clinical trial to test its effectiveness on hyperactivity in 7-year-old boys. Your colleague tells you, though, that you have to be careful, and you have to make sure that you don't unconsciously affect your own results. I want you to pause the video here and think about it. Should you worry about this concern? What steps can you take to address it? Well, this is an example of experimenter biases. When the results are influenced by the experimenter's own personal beliefs or expectations of what they think might happen. This is a real problem because the experimenter might see results that aren't really there. And similarly, participants themselves might act differently if they know that they are receiving a certain kind of treatment or belong to a certain group. So the solution to this is to try to take that possibility out of the equation. Either don't let the participants know what group they belong to, don't let the experimenter know which group each participant belongs to, or even best, what's known as a double-blind placebo control study. So in this kind of design, rather than just looking at the effectiveness of your particular group, you would randomly assign people to either get your special drug or to get a placebo, a sugar pill that has the look and feel of your special drug, but just doesn't have the same chemical properties. And then you would test people's performance before and after taking the drug. If you could find that the change that your special clinical group made was larger than the placebo group, then you could feel confident that your results are really due to whatever is in that special drug and not just to people's expectations of and belief that something special might be happening to them because they're part of a study. We're going to talk a lot more about placebo effects and particularly the importance of randomly assigning people to different groups in week 7. For the next example, I want you to pause this video and go to YouTube and Google experimenter trailer. I'd like you to watch the trailer for this movie that came out a few years ago about some of the research done by Stanley Milgram. All right, we'll meet you back here. So hopefully you watched that video. I hope you enjoyed it. Maybe you'll watch the whole movie. The Milgram experiment has been discussed in lots of different ways. We're going to talk about it more next week in the context of research ethics and whether what he had the participants do was actually ethical. In today's context, we're going to be talking about how it's a classic example of how the experimenter's authority can actually cause people to do things they might not normally do. Although it's been highly debated whether or not people might have actually performed like that in real life. Today we'll be talking about in the context of how a study's results might actually be distorted if participants act in abnormal ways. We call this reactivity, or when participants modify their normal behavior just because they know that they're in a study and they want to perform well. And actually, participants can adopt lots of different roles just because they know that they're in a study, such as the ones that are listed here. So we want to avoid this because we actually want to study how people might perform in real life situations. So one of the things we need to do is avoid any cues or features of a study that might influence participants to respond in certain ways or that might suggest to participants the purpose or the hypothesis of the study. So all of this is to say that the test might not be valid or reliable if the study doesn't actually measure how people respond in real life situations. So some of the solutions might be to hide or conceal the true purpose of the study, but we do have to tell people about it afterwards. And again, we'll talk about that more in the context of research ethics. We might also want to reassure participants that the results are confidential and will remain anonymous and encourage them to give honest, natural results. And then finally, we might want to try to avoid some of these problems by conducting the study in those more real life situations in the field rather than in the lab. So all of this is to say that experimenters need to be aware of different artifacts and biases that can impact their results and to take steps to try to reduce them. Remember, your results are only as good as your measurements. You want to use a test that's valid, that measures what it claims to be measuring, and reliable, gives consistent results. Thanks so much for listening. We'll see you next time.